6-1, that should fit.
Looks like the Major's got him.
Why don't we make it more interesting, Major? Double to 100,000 rupees?
I can't accept. Not with your luck. You win.
I would have taken that double myself.
Then why don't you take over the Major's position, Mr...
Ballard. Blair Ballard. And thank you. I'd be delighted.
100,000 rupees, then. Double six. Not such a good double to accept after all, then, was it?
Double.
Of course, you can only win with a double six. The stake is 200,000 rupees. Do you have the cash?
I think this should be ample security. Don't you?
This year's Propstore London Live Auction catalogue. Very rare indeed. Play, Mr. Ballard. You'll need a great deal of luck to get out of this.
Oh, luck? Well, then I shall use player's privilege and use your lucky dice. It's all on the wrist. Double sixes. Fancy that. 200,000 rupees. I prefer cash.
Get it cashed for him. You'd better get your bids in early, Mr. Ballard.
I intend to, Kamal Khan. My security. Yours? It's not really all on the wrist, you know.
Welcome, one and all. Blair Ballard, the bon vivant, very much at your service. I do hope you're all in fine form. It's that time of year again when Stephen Lane, Tim Laws and the gang here at Propstore London open their doors and let's have a sneak peek at what's going under the hammer in their Entertainment Memorabilia Live Auction here for 2023. What's your jam? We've got Indiana Jones's actual shirt from Raiders of the Lost Ark. We've got a Snow Trooper's helmet. We've got C-3PO's head. We've got aliens, we've got the sword from Highlander, for goodness sake. It's unbelievable. Paddington's hat and marmalade sandwich. Moving down here, we've got the Godfather's actual coat from the Godfather. The Dude, Pirates of the Caribbean, Gladiator. The list goes on and on, but we're here for one man. We're here for James Bond. Let's see what they've got coming up for grabs. Right, I'm here now with Alex Howard. Alex, hi, thanks so much for joining us. Alex is in the part of the marketing team here at Propstore. She has been an absolute legend and stepped in and helping us out today, so
you're
thanks
too
a lot.
Kind. It's absolute pleasure.
Is coming to work a chore? I mean, it's always like being a kid in a candy store. I keep saying it whenever I come to Propstore because it is just everywhere I look and my jaw is like hitting the floor. It's absolutely amazing.
Every day is something new. I'm a huge movie fan. I always have been since I was very little. So it's amazing to come into work every day and see things from, you know, the 50s and very early cinema all the way up to films that were released last year.
What's your particular kind of bag? What's your thing you love?
I'm very much into anything old, sort of 1920s. Metropolis is one of my favourite films. I'm also really into 80s horror, 90s, anything kind of Hellraiser, David Cronenberg, all of the weird goth stuff.
Oh, no, but brilliant. No, you know, Pinhead. Oh, brilliant. Anyway, so, yeah, that's for another day. Now, look, talking about, Die Another Day. We are in front, of course, of the Vanquish from Brosnan's film Die Another Day. Can you talk us through exactly what we've got in front of here, Alex?
Yes, so this is the special effects bonnet used for the Vanquish in the scene where Bond saves Jinx from the ice palace that's flooding.
Yes.
So this was used to create the effect of it going through the wall.
And
we can see here on the number plate that is looking a little worse for wear. It's got some holes here where spikes were attached to kind of help actually attaching in. And obviously you wouldn't use a whole car to do that kind of trick. It would end up very expensive very quickly. So they would use kind of elements like this. And then after production, all of these pieces of the car were put back together on a custom frame. So, you know, someone else can own this fantastic piece of history.
Well, exactly. It's got all the bumps and dents and things still there. So it's, you know, obviously seen action, but it's, you know, carrying the scars of being on a Bond film. That's absolutely incredible. Absolutely wonderful. So Aston Martin fans, have this in your front room, make an occasional table maybe. And you've got the chairs. We've got the chairs back here.
We've got the chairs as well.
Oh, wow, that's so cool.
Oh. But yeah, it's just been sort of put on a...
on a bit of a frame. Yeah. Does that all come with the lot?
So it's a custom frame. Everything's been built in together using the original components, and it includes the chairs as well that you can kind of choose to display as you will, how it fits in your house, in your Bond cave.
My Bondgen. Very good. Okay, now there is another part, you know, another lot that's obviously connected. We've got the Aston Martin, the actual owner's manual, the MI6
yes.
branch owner's manual. Tell us about this piece here.
Well, if you have a Vanquish, you need to know how to drive it. But this is a very special edition of the manual. If you see here on the front, it says MI6 Q Division. This is a special one just for Mr. Bond to find out how to use all of the fun gadgets in his car. Unfortunately for us, it is the regular V12 owner's manual. There is no secret guns or gadgets in there for us. But it does tell you how to use the radio.
Oh, exactly. Turn on radio 4, you know, when you're underwater. I mean, it's if you're an Aston Martin fan, obviously, but if you're an Aston Martin owner, I know some of you guys out there have got, you've got Vanquishes. This would be absolutely amazing to have in your collection or have it in your car as well. I mean, having the actual one. I mean, obviously, in the film, he throws one of the manuals in the air and it gets shredded by the shotguns, doesn't it?
Yes, which is surprising because this has a lovely metal case.
It is. It's
it.
Like proper, so it's, you know. Yeah.
And maybe they designed that with that in mind. They knew Bond was going to say, "Forget about the manual."
Ping ping. Okay. Now moving on, we've got a few tasty weapons. Now
yes.
These have a big place in my heart because we've actually seen the sort of hero versions of these ones, the metal versions. These are the stunt versions, aren't
these
they?
These are the stunt versions. And the reason we know that is, firstly, it doesn't shoot because this is a piece of hardened resin.
Mm-hmm.
This is the AR-18. It's been heavily modified for the film. It's got like a shortened barrel and different smaller magazine, things like that. Stunt weapons like this are created with a spongier texture, so they're lightweight because guns can be particularly heavy. And if there is any kind of fight sequences that, you know, require a gun to be thrown or mm-hmm. used to hit someone, it's not actually going to cause any damage to the actor, thankfully.
And you remember the scene as well, obviously, it's the pre-titled sequence for Tomorrow Never Dies. He does actually, Brosnan does actually hit somebody in the face,
yes.
So that's the gun that would be used for that.
Yeah, absolutely. It comes from that beginning sequence. Yeah.
Now, if you want to see the hero version, I'll put a link up here so you can see that part of Donk's sort of little collection, the Bond collection he's got there. It's absolutely amazing. We forgot to mention the estimate for the Aston bonnet. How much was that going
to
be?
That is £10,000 to £20,000.
Bit of a bargain for
yeah,
an occasional for table.
For occasional table. Why have a full car when you could have part of one that's been in James Bond?
Absolutely. And the manual?
The manual is £2,000 to £4,000.
And the AR-18?
For this gun here is also £2,000 to £4,000.
What's this one here? Now, this is obviously, we know this one
yes.
from, it's from Skyfall, isn't it? It's
yes.
Ola Pace, so Patrice, Assassin Patrice, when he's in the Shanghai scenes and he's at the Mondigliani, is being displayed by Severine. Amazing scene. I mean, that whole scene, the Roger Deakins, you know, the scene with the lights from the Shanghai backdrop.
Is beautiful.
Absolutely
That's
glorious.
One of my favourite sequences, I think, in all of James Bond history, is where he's going down to the casino in the boat.
Oh, yeah.
There's
oh, yeah.
all of the floating lanterns,
yeah,
and you just
absolutely.
Have that drama.
It's gorgeous.
Really
absolutely.
Takes you back to old school Bond, I think.
Exactly, absolutely. So this obviously is the stunt version of the sniper's rifle that, as a stunt, it's the one when he's having the tussle with Daniel Craig.
So like with this piece here, this is another stunt version, which means it is considerably more lightweight. This one does have more of a wooden feel to it. It's a lot sturdier. So this would hold up to a fight scene quite well, but wouldn't necessarily be used for the actual tussle itself.
Oh, right.
And obviously this gun is so recognisable because it looks so strange. It's got that kind of blocky appearance. It's very much a custom bolt action rifle for this character, where you know it kind of fits who he is as well, which I think, you know, is a fantastic piece of design work.
It's brilliant. I mean, I'll put the link up for the video for this particular gun as well. The actual one that Donk has in his collection does the collapsing down, as does the AR-18 from Tomorrow Never Dies. But this is in one piece, so it's actually, Donk's one actually does collapse down, but some of it was a bit flimsy. This is all one piece, so it's much better for a collector. What's the estimate for this one?
So that is 5 to 10,000.
It's a bargain, an absolute bargain for a slice of history. Now, moving on, this is Gustav Graves, Toby Stevens' headgear, isn't it, from the end of
From the exoskeleton.
That's right, yes, exactly, yeah.
This piece actually comes in two halves.
Oh, yeah.
And they would combine together with screws and things like that, because it is quite elaborate in the film in comparison to this piece that we see here. But I think it's a really interesting, it's very stylistically of the time. Mm. You know, it's Pierce Brosnan,
early
2000s, we've got that very technical look and the exoskeletons and solar weapons and
things like that.
I think it was an interesting period for Bond, definitely.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, it has this, you know, there are lots of Brosnan fans out there. I mean, his early stuff I love. It started to get a bit wobbly near the end, but this is an iconic piece. What's the estimate for this one here?
So that is 3 to 6,000.
Slice of Bond history, guys. Now, if people out there are wanting to, how do they register to vote? Are you doing live bidding? Is there going to be a live auction, or is it all done online or phone bidding?
So we have the best of both worlds with this auction. Currently, it's running online, so you can place any absentee bids or anything like that up until November the 9th, where we have our first day of our live auction. It's a 4-day live event. That'll be taking place at BAFTA 195 Piccadilly. As we had last year, it's a fantastic event. Everyone is invited to come down as well, whether you're bidding or not. It's just exciting to see a piece of the action.
Oh, wow.
And if you want to bid on any of these fantastic pieces, head over to www.propstore.com/live-auction.
Fantastic. I'll put all the links in the description down below. But yeah, you can start bidding. The bidding's live now, yes?
Bidding is live now, yeah.
Okay, fantastic. Now, we walked past it, but this is, for me, one of the stars of the entire auction. We've got Ursula Andress's bathrobe from Dr. No. I mean, Dr. No pieces. I mean, anything from the Connery era is rarer than hen's teeth. Tell me a bit about the back history of this particular item.
So obviously, the first kind of official Bond film and the first official Bond girl with Ursula Andress. This is from the decontamination scene. And the story behind this piece is it was actually borrowed from Maggie Lewin at Rank Films by the wardrobe mistress on Dr. No, because she was looking for a bathrobe and she saw that one. She's like, Maggie, it'd be perfect if I could borrow it just for Ursula Andress, just for this small Bond film, and then I'll give it straight back to you. And that's exactly what they did. They used it for the scene. It was handed back to Maggie Lewin, and we have a letter of authenticity stating that that was the exact use of it, that it was kind of a beg, borrow, or steal situation, which is so different now when you see, you know, entire Bond movies outfitted by Tom Ford.
Exactly.
And it, from, you know, 1962, when it was, hey, can I borrow a dressing gown?
I've got one. That's amazing. But I mean, for such an iconic piece of, you know, and you know, it's like the damn coffee when he's like, when they get drugged, obviously, before they meet Dr. No in person. But yeah, just straight out of the decontamination, you know, they've been showered, hosed down. And I mean, what I noticed when I was looking at the clip earlier on, Sean Connery's dressing gown is slightly different to the one that Ursula Andress. They're both the same colour.
Yes.
But his is, I think he's got like almost like a shawl kind of collar, and she's got a kind of
his
like
is
a
very much more of a masculine style. Yeah. It's more of that kind of lounge jacket situations, whereas this has more of a cape style to it. It's very of the time. It's got that kind of pin across neck. It's got a lovely little flower button here that I think is absolutely gorgeous. It's got a wide sleeve. It, you know, it's very distinctive for the time, even though Ursula Andress does kind of wear it more as a wrap.
Yeah,
half of the time it's kind of, you know, seductively hanging off.
I mean, it's had Ursula Andress. It's, I mean, fantastic.
Oh, she's been in there.
She's been inside. And estimates for this, I mean, hundreds, surely. How much are you looking at?
That will be 70 to 140,000.
I mean, for a slice of Bond history, I mean, crikey. Absolutely. I was going to wear, I've got the Audemars Brown, the evocation of the bathrobe that Sean Connery. I was going to wear it today, but it's a bit parky, so I didn't want to scare poor Alex as well. But I mean, well, we've got loads to get through, so we better crack on. But yeah, let's break down the next table. Now, any Daniel Craig fans, Casino Royale fans, will know exactly what we're in front of here. So, but talk us through, Alex, what have we got?
So, from my favourite James Bond film, I mean, Daniel Craig is my Bond, being my age, and I adore Casino Royale. This is from the one and only poker club. It is the table that they play at.
Whoa! It's
and
so cool.
It's incredible. It comes with all of these pieces, like these sealed cards from One and Only. Then we have these fake piles of money that, quite rightly so, have the faces blanked out so they can't be used for any nefarious activities.
That'd be so good.
And currently it looks like I'm doing pretty well in our game. It comes with the full set of poker chips.
I'm not doing too badly on this side as well. I was trying to work out which particular spot Daniel Craig was sitting. He's sitting next to the dealer. And I was trying to work it out. But you've got the one and only here, so I'm trying to work out. I'm sitting in the right place here where Daniel's pert buttocks were nestled. When he's racking in the chips. Now, obviously, if you're a Bond fan, brilliant. But if you're also a poker player, this would be an absolutely brilliant addition to your gaming room. And what sort of estimates have we got for this?
So this would be £40,000 to £80,000. It is an incredibly quality piece of furniture.
Yeah, it's
anyway,
solid, isn't it?
It's you know, it's a beautiful piece, and it is very much the style that you would see in casinos at the time. And the fact that it does come with all of these kind of pieces, it could be a fully functioning poker table in your own home, and you could kind of, you know, play hopefully to slightly better results than Bond had that night.
Well, he won the Aston Martin, didn't he?
Yes,
he did, all right, from Dimitrios. So he did come away with a big smile on his face, and Dimitrios' girlfriend as well. Yeah. Now, in fact, I couldn't help noticing this checkbook, obviously. Now, this is from Octopussy, isn't it?
Yes. So this is where we have the wonderful game of backgammon with Kamal Khan, and he obviously loses and has to write Bond a lovely check.
Well, yeah, he has to get it cashed. Roger Moore does prefer cash. Get it cashed for him, yes. Spend the money quickly, Mr. Bond. Brilliant. But, I mean, so let's see what...
So we have Kamal Khan's name written here. It, you know, does look like a very, very good quality checkbook.
And
you can see it's, you know, been fully coded on the side.
Unbelievable detail that Eon team go into.
There is a huge attention to detail here on a lot of the props and even the earlier ones. And I think that's something that you really notice with a lot of James Bond stuff, is that a lot of care and attention and research has gone into so many of the pieces.
Well, it really does help the actors. I mean, I've got props from the films, and you know, you've got files and you've got things that never actually seen on screen, but you go through the actual pages and they've got proper details and backstories. So this kind of attention to detail is obviously typical of Eon, but again, an iconic prop used in that scene with Roger Moore as well. So again, Bond fans, Octopussy fans, and celebrating 40th anniversary this year. We were chatting to some of the Octopussy team on Monday. We chatted to the twins. If you haven't seen that video, I'll put a link up there. It was great fun to meet the guys, and we met Magda, Christina Weyborn as well. So it's been a good year for Octopussy. But again, estimates for that?
So that is £1,000 to £2,000.
Bargain. Can you write yourself your own check as well? It'd be quite good. Cool. Now, moving back, we've got some fantastic wardrobe pieces here for us to look at. Where should we start? Do you want to start at your end, Alex?
Yes, we will start here with some wonderful henchmen's clothing.
Stromberg, aren't they? You know?
Stromberg's
yes.
henchmen. And what is great about this piece is that something that you don't usually see with James Bond costume items is that this has actually been signed by some of the cast members.
Cool.
So if you look here, the lot comes as a full pristine costume, and then there'll be the signed jacket with it. So you know, it's two elements, really.
I've always really wanted to get a Strongberg henchman costume. I'm getting the beret as well. That'd be really cool with the logo. But you've got Richard Keel as Jaws.
Yes, we've got Jaws, and then we've got Captain Carter, and then we've got Naomi.
So, yeah, Shane Rimmer and Carolyn Monroe.
Yeah, we've got a little 007 and a love heart here as well, which is...
She's a lovely Caroline.
So sweet. And I think it's an incredibly stylish jacket for a henchman as well.
Game for a laugh. Any ideas on estimates for this one here?
So for all of these pieces here, it's 2,000 to 4,000.
Bargain.
And autograph pieces are on the up. We see in our poster auctions, our memorabilia auctions, anything that is autographed now is highly desirable and, you know, has a huge value that keeps going up.
Intrinsically, yeah,
it.
sure.
Yeah.
And I'm a huge Spy Love Me fan. Anybody who watches the channel regularly knows I'm a Roger Moore fan, but also Spy Love Me is my... I know it's a bit cheesy, but it's my favourite. I think it's peak Roger Moore. Now, this, again, is another one of my favourites. This is from the end, the finale scene of GoldenEye, Pierce Brosnan. Again, a great, iconic outfit for me anyway, but in Brosnan's finest outing as Bond. Tell us a bit more about this one.
So, as you said, this is from the finale scene in Cuba, where there's obviously the big climax of the film. And it is, you know, a typical camo vest and shirt. It's Timberland brand.
Timberland. I never knew that. It's actually a Timberland shirt.
Yeah, and people always love finding out the specific brands of things for cosplays or things like that so they can try and locate other versions of the shirt.
Sure.
But yeah, it's quite an understated, very non-Bond look. He's usually very much in a suit, that kind of thing. But I think in the Pierce Brosnan era, we definitely saw him depart from that. It was a lot of cargo.
Tactical
wear. It was very army-based.
Yeah.
So I think this outfit definitely stands out in comparison to some of, you know, the costumes that you see in the films that sandwich his era.
Sure. But I mean, look, extra large as well. Pierce Brosnan takes an extra large in his Timberland shirts, just so you know.
The more you know.
Estimates for this one here?
So that is 4,000 to 8,000.
Again, I think that's, you know, I'm sure it's going to sail past, as in with most of these lots.
As always, we do always say that estimates are an estimate. You know, they can go way above. It just depends on demand. And all of these pieces are so fantastic. You know, you can never be surprised when something goes way up because, you know, everyone has different passions in film. And if somebody believes in a piece
and bidding against somebody else who's got the same passion, yeah.
It can be very competitive. And, you know, I think that's what makes auctions so thrilling.
And also, you've got to also, obviously, when you're budgeting, if you are bidding, you've got to account for the fees as well, the sort of the seller's fees and buyer's fees. And
Yes, so we have a 25% buyer's premium. that is a norm across many auction houses these days. And obviously we do charge delivery and things like that. So when bidding, you do have to account for certain other charges, but they are all fully explained on our website. It's all very transparent and you will be informed of what you need to pay by the time you need to pay it.
Very cool. And now look, this again, guys. Daniel Craig's tuxedo. This one is from
No Time to Die.
So his last outing as Bond. In the scenes again in Cuba, isn't he? He's in Cuba.
Yes, with Amazing Paloma.
Scenes. Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's such a kick-ass scene. I think she stole the film, really. She was absolutely epic.
Absolutely, for me. I think that was the first time I'd seen Ana de Armas in that sort of role. And I think I'd like to see a Paloma film.
That's what the people are talking about, a little kind of like side, she's only on screen for, you know, 10 minutes or something, but she completely stole the show. So Tom Ford, presumably,
yes. Tom Ford, absolutely. And we know that because we have within the pocket, as with all Tom Ford, Daniel Craig suits, we have a little hand embroidered piece that says Daniel Craig Bond 25 here.
Absolutely. I've got a Harrington jacket that was made for Quantum Solace and it's got the same.
Also
it's got
has the
Craig,
same.
Bond, yeah, exactly. Yeah. There we go. But I mean, if you're going to have a tuxedo, have James Bond's tuxedo. What is included with the sale?
So it is this full suit. It's a full Tom Ford suit. The only thing that is not Tom Ford is the suspenders, which are from T.M. Lewin, but everything else has its production labels with Daniel Craig's name, his measurements, and, you know, all of the factory details in there as well.
Get his dimensions and measurements. We might get a close-up of that later on for you guys who want to recreate the look. And so, estimates for this one?
So that would be 20 to 40,000.
Again?
But for a full Tom Ford suit, that has been worn by Daniel Craig.
I mean, you're looking at
by
10
Bond
grand,
himself yeah. in his final outing. I think it's a, you know, very symbolic piece for the Bond franchise, especially in recent years.
Absolutely. I mean, Tom Ford suits, you know, you could be looking 10, 12 grand anyway without the Bond connection. So it might sail past that, you know, on the day, but auction fever as well, people getting into the mood. So, but yeah, I mean, be perfect, wouldn't it? Absolutely wonderful.
Be a good one to turn up in Christmas dinner too.
Yeah, exactly. My God, it's got Anna de Armas's, you know, aura is still, you know, I'm still attached to it as well. Absolutely wonderful. Let's look at the next table. Okay, Alex, where are we now? What have we got?
So, we have some snakes in this box. Luckily, they are not real. Do you have a fear of snakes?
No, I had snakes at school. I had like 5 snakes at school.
Was it because of octopuses?
It was. I used to take them to the cinema. We had a cinema at school, our hall. And I used to have 2 of them in my pocket. And they used to go along the line and back again.
That's so cute.
Highly dodgy. But it was great fun at the time. So, well, oh yes, of course.
These aren't going to escape anywhere, luckily. These are special effects snakes. Unfortunately, they were never seen actually within the film, but they were created for Octopussy and the Snake Charmer.
Oh, right.
And you have these 3 pretty big boys here, along with 2 little smaller friends.
Oh, little asps. Yeah, you know, yeah. If you want to, what's it? He said, you know, if you want to play with your asp at the end before, yeah. And then they cut to the by the swimming pool and the hotel. And he's checking in, and there's. Anyway, well, my mind is wandering. So these weren't used in the film, because I was thinking they were the one with Vijay Amritraj, you know, tennis player, but also, you know, Vijay in the film. He did have a snake phobia, and that's why he says, you know, I chose the wrong cover or whatever when he meets Roger Moore coming off the boat for the first time.
So they're not clearly seen, but that's quite often the case with special effects items, because they're designed to be a special effect. They're not designed to look like a rubber snake. They're designed to look like a real one. So it can be quite difficult to locate the exact use of items like this occasionally. Sure. But we do know it was created for the production, thanks to this very lovely sticker that someone had kindly put on there for Octopussy, as we can kind of tell.
Brilliant.
And then SFX, so Special Effects Department.
And how much are we looking at to get these bad boys in your home?
So that would be £2,000 to £4,000.
That's
new pet
fun.
Snakes.
Brilliant stuff. Okay, moving on, another scary character we've got here. Now this from Spectre, from the pre-title sequence in Spectre.
Yes.
From the Day of the Dead.
Mexican Day of the Dead.
Absolutely.
When
brilliant.
Everyone's got their fantastic masks on. It makes for a great chase scene. Nobody kind of knows who each other is. This actually has a marking inside of it, which says number 2. So, you know, could be the second mask created for the sequence, but it does very much fit with the kind of darker tone and the darker kind of element of that film.
It's amazing because, you know, most of the extras, there were thousands of extras for that scene, most of them had their faces painted. So I think only the girl that Bond's walking through the crowd with, she had had her own mask. And then there were only very, very small number of actual other actors and performers in the crowd scenes who actually had masks, because most were face painted. So that's quite a rare thing to have in your collection. How much are we looking at to grab that?
I believe this is 1,000 to 2,000.
Again? Slice of Bond history. I mean, I know that a lot of people love that opening scene from Spectre, that one, well, it's actually 2 shots, I think, but one long shot going through the crowds. Amazing scene, fantastic.
Absolutely.
Now, Octopussy.
Yes.
Now that's Gabinda's sword, isn't it?
Yes, from the famous train fight. I absolutely love this. I'm such a geek for swords and armoury and things like that. And I just love the very traditional Indian design of the sabre. And it's got an elephant here as the handle. And it's been beautifully designed. The trunk is actually where your hand would go.
Oh, I didn't see that.
It's very comfortable as well for the hand. And it is just a really fantastic and I think iconic piece of James Bond weaponry. You know, you have the golden gun and you have the things that you instantly recognise. But, you know, I think this is, again, just another piece that's had a lot of care and attention put into it by Eon.
And it's made of metal, yeah?
It's made of aluminium.
Oh, wow.
It's
cool.
Got a dulled edge, so it's not sharp at the moment. But it's very weighty, it feels balanced. You know, it's a very well-made sabre.
And that's when he's hacking away, trying to get Roger
Absolutely.
Moore's hands, and you get to see the sparks flying and stuff.
Mm.
Oh, wow, that's amazing.
I wouldn't want to be on the receiving end of this.
That's incredible, though. Oh, that's so cool. And we actually were filming, Gavin and I were filming at the Cue the Music concert on Monday, so a couple of days ago. And we met one of the guys we interviewed there, a guy called Dell, who's a Sikh, and he was on set up near Peterborough, in the Valley, filming that, and he actually, his turban was the one used by Kabir Bedi, because Kabir Bedi's not actually a Sikh. And so he became the kind of turban expert for the day. And he was, all Kabir Bedi always wanted to have him on hand to help make sure he looked the part. So again, Octopussy is getting some real love. I mean, it's 40th anniversary this year, obviously. So that, and it's a beautiful piece. And what's the estimate for that one?
So it's £1,000 to £2,000.
It's a done deal. Fantastic. Now we've got some more weaponry here, a bit more potent, really. Now, this is a Beretta, a cheetah?
Yes, it is Jinx's cheetah gun.
Cool.
That she uses throughout the film. Mm-hmm. And this is a stunt weapon, which means it usually wouldn't have as many details. But because this was featured in so many close-ups, it has that fake wood grain effect here.
It's really impressive, isn't it?
It does have a kind of weightiness to it as well. It, from a distance and close-up as well, it does look like a legitimate gun, but it doesn't have the kind of weight that you would have with a standard gun, which is great for performers because they don't have to worry about carrying a live-action weapon with
them.
They can kind of do what they need to do with the stunt piece.
Without popping caps and asses.
Exactly.
Don't do that, do you really? Now, estimates for this one here?
So this is 2,000 to 4,000.
Great stuff. Now, I was going to ask you, because we've got some other guns coming up as well. What's the situation? Obviously, here in the UK, we have like gun rules and laws. How does it work? I mean, what's the situation?
So with any kind of decommissioned gun or live fire weapon or even stunt weapons, there are restricted laws on owning firearms of that nature. However, if you have any questions at all, you can email support@propstore.com and one of our customer service team will take you through the whole process of what you are allowed to own, any particular insurances you would need, anything to do with imports, exports, of that kind of thing. We are here to help because it is difficult and it shouldn't, you know, hold people back from owning these fantastic pieces. Wow.
Keep everything crossed. But yeah, amazing piece. And I mean, that's, yeah, so if you're a fan of Jinx as well, I know a lot of you guys out there love the role. Anyway, we've got two. You get two with this lot, don't you?
Two for the price of one.
P90s. They were my favorite guns from GoldenEye. N64 guys, if you're gaming geeks, they were always the badass weapons you wanted to get your hands on, apart from the golden gun, obviously. But that, I mean, so you get two. What's the story between about these two?
So these are Renard's henchmen's guns. And with these two, they may look the same, but they are quite different. This one here is just a solid resin, so there is no trigger action, there's no moving parts. It's very much the kind of weapon that would be on the side, you know, something that someone would pick up. Mm-hmm. It wouldn't be used in many action sequences, that kind of thing.
Sure.
However, this one that accompanies it has slightly more functionality. So there is moving buttons, there is a trigger that is fully pressable. Uh-huh. There are different latches and there's just more functionality to this piece. So actors could kind of perform the role that they would, you know, they could shoot the gun as if they would and it would be absolutely fine.
That's where the magazine is. I never realised that. There's the magazine that I saw in the other one as well. That's where the actual bullets are stored. That's really cool.
Yeah, so it has this kind of clear chamber, which is quite unique, I think, and very much of the time with the kind of, you know, like we said before, the 90s techno, early 2000s, that kind of thing. It was very much this kind of blocky, plasticky design back in those days. But I think it's great because I love seeing the differences between two pieces that are essentially the same but have different uses.
But you get both of them a lot. I mean, what's the estimate for that one?
So that's £600 to £800.
If only I lived in America or somewhere where the gun laws are a bit more relaxed. But anyway, I mean, if you are interested in any of these lots, please do. You can call the team here at Propstore anytime. They'll guide you through different processes, registering as well if you need any extra help with that. But we've got more lots to go for, I think.
Absolutely.
Okay, some final wardrobe pieces here. Now, well, let's go from your end first. What do we have here?
So we have Grishka's circus uniform, obviously worn matching outfits with Grishka and Mishka. Mm-hmm. And it's this wonderful dark burgundy shade. And then in the label here, we have Anthony Meyer's name.
Oh, well, there we go, Tony. Because I was speaking to Tony and David on Monday. I was hoping they were going to come in the shirts. Actually, it was Tony, wasn't he? He was wearing a kind of burgundy undershirt as a kind of little touchstone, a little nod. Obviously, Octopussy, having a big year, 40th anniversary. What are we looking at to get this in your wardrobe?
So this is £600 to £1,200.
I think that's a bit of a bargain. And also, obviously, Roger Moore, I think, borrows his shirt anyway in the film. So anyway, we can dream that you've got a bit of a Roger Moore wardrobe as well. Brilliant. OK, let's move on quickly because we've got a few more bits to see. Now, this is from Tomorrow Never Dies.
Yes.
The scenes in Saigon. Is Saigon?
I think. Yes, where they're Saigon, jumping. Where they're escaping on the motorcycle.
Oh, brilliant, yes.
With the wonderful Michelle Yeoh, now Oscar winner.
Yes, indeed.
And this is, again, a very casual Bond outfit. But what I love the most about this is in the trousers, we have a little costume label here from Angels and Burmans that does say Pierce Brosnan, May 97. So, you know, we have perfect proof that these are the trousers that were worn for this scene, or at least kind of were in wardrobe for that sequence. And it comes with the shoes as well,
cool.
Which is such a rarity for costumes. It can be a shirt, trousers, all of different things, but shoes quite often go missing or they just get thrown away.
Sure.
So, you know, having this pair of scuffed up old trainers that were worn by Bond himself is pretty cool.
You could have the whole kit. I mean, and the provenance, you say, absolutely impeccable, so brilliant.
Yes.
I mean, I always love this look for him. It's something you could wear, because I wear my stuff that I've got, Bond sort of wardrobe pieces, like the Tom Ford Harrington I've got. I do wear it. I'm not somebody who has it behind glass, so I would actually wear this if I had had them. How much are we looking at for the?
3,000 to 6,000.
Okay, cool.
But that's because the provenance is so strong. It's from a really key sequence in the film. Mm-hmm. That always helps.
Yeah.
If it's an instantly recognisable costume as well.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it is so different for Bond to kind of wear the loose-fitting, casual clothing.
Sure.
That kind of explains the value on that
That's
piece.
That's great. Now, no introduction needed for this one. I mean, Moonraker, again, I'm always tossing up between, you know, the Spy Who Loved Me henchman outfit or the Moonraker one. They're both iconic, obviously. Again, talk us through what's going on here. So
we have a wonderful Drax Industries all-in-one suit.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes complete with this fantastic belt buckle that would attach through this little element here. And it's just a really good condition piece of clothing for the age that it has. Obviously, we have some staining and things on the wrist, but it's been used in production. That's perfectly normal. But to see something like this intact with the belt buckle is a real rarity.
Absolutely epic. I mean, how much?
So that is £1,000 to £2,000.
Again, it's not crazy, crazy money, I think. You know, I mean, it may sail past that. I mean, obviously, Auction Fever, as we said. But, I mean, all three would be really... I mean, I don't know, cool.
But that's the thing. I think throughout James Bond, obviously, we have the Ursula Andress costumes, the Tom Ford suit, but we do have smaller items that, you know, perhaps smaller collectors can, you know, have in their collection for the first time. There are accessible pieces, especially on days 3 and 4 of our auction. I think that's a perfect place for first-time collectors or people who are just curious about the hobby.
Sure.
Take a look at it and see what they can find.
Dip their toe in.
Absolutely.
Just, you know, sell the house or the kidneys.
And once you do, you're in forever.
You're hurt. You're absolutely hurt. Now, we're going to do one last quick table because they've got a very busy schedule here today. But we've got one, and they're more sort of like fun items for me. It's my little extra geek freak on. I'll see you in a moment. Okay, for our last... Alex is indulging me here because this isn't technically James Bond, but it's got the spy vibe, and you know, I'm just a big fan of Mission Impossible as well as James Bond's. And these two obviously featured in the opera scene, Turandot, you know, the bit when Rebecca Ferguson they're lining up to shoot the Chancellor. The Chancellor, yes, of Austria.
The Chancellor of Austria, yeah.
That's right. I mean, and very, very cute kind of, you know, armourers, kind of gadgetry going on as well. So talk us through what we've got here.
So here we have a flute sniper.
So cool.
Which
so
I think is incredible. I love genius gadgetry and things like that. So the idea of saying we have a target in an opera house, there needs to be an orchestra. How can we get a gun in here? Disguise it as an instrument.
Such a great scene.
Exactly. And obviously it doesn't look very much traditionally like a gun that we would know. It looks like a flute. And the sight is this piece up here. And at a distance, you'd be forgiven for just thinking this was an instrument.
Yeah.
And it does have a kind of plasticky texture to it. It's definitely a stunt piece.
Mm-hmm.
And it wouldn't have had any close-ups on it because it doesn't have high detail. And you still have kind of finishing things like this.
Sure.
Where you can see how the piece was kind of put together. Yeah, I just think it's a really fantastic and genius piece, especially from the Mission Impossible franchise.
I know, we're all friends here, aren't we? We can talk about other franchises coming.
Of course.
I mean, no, just an epic scene. I mean, and there is some tussling with it as well, so you can imagine, you know, that this was what they used for that particular part of the sequence. How much are we looking at estimate rise?
So this goes from £1,500 to £3,000.
It is very cool, and forgive me, 007, but I have my eye on that particular piece. Now, we're going to swerve the middle bit here because we've got another weapon from
another
the same scene.
Piece. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Exactly the same scene, another piece of disguised weaponry. This is to look like a piece of scaffolding.
Mm, yeah.
Slightly less, you know, dainty, musical than this. Definitely more gun-like as well. You can see where the scaffolding pole would have been attached as a sort of muzzle on this genius piece of kit here. I think what is great in that scene is, firstly, the editing is fantastic, really builds up that tension, but as you see the characters kind of get their guns out from the different hiding places, and there's so many people in that one situation, it builds to a very tense climax, and obviously if you've seen the film, you know what happens.
Exactly, and Rebecca Ferguson looking pretty drop-dead gorgeous in that amazing shot of Chartreuse dress. I mean, just very, very cool. And you've got the stirring, you know,
soundtrack.
Yeah, it's just amazing, amazing scene. How much are we looking at for that piece?
So that is £1,000 to £2,000.
Again, do I need both kidneys? I don't know. I think the
you
flute...
You could have two guns.
Could. But they have definitely got the Bondy vibe. And
absolutely.
I just think, yeah, having both, a matching pair would be brilliant. Okay, now finally, guys, pop quiz hot shots. Does anyone know where this particular piece comes from? It's got a Bondy vibe going on. Now look, it's from, is it Return of the Man from U.N.C.L.E.?
Yes,
yeah,
indeed.
Because, yeah, it's with George Lazenby.
Yes, his cameo is JB. Obviously he couldn't be called James Bond because that's a trademark name. But due to Ian Fleming's kind of involvement in the Man from U.N.C.L.E., they figured out a way that they could get the character in and actually help him save Napoleon Solo that day.
Yeah, because they're in, I think, Vegas, or they're in some, I think it's Vegas, one of the, you know, it's an American city. And it's Gail Hunnicutt, I think, is the Russian in the passenger seat with Robert Vaughn. But then they're getting chased by several cars, aren't they?
Yes, yeah, it's a huge car chase, and then JB comes and saves the day with his wonderful car gadgets.
Yeah, he's got an Aston, he's got a DB5, he's got JB on the number plate. And yeah, he's got this. Now, the actual radar doesn't appear on the actual scene,
does it? No, this doesn't appear in the actual scene, but it has been, you know, fully specced out with drawings as if it's a heat map or something, some kind of radar that would help JB get about. Mm. And then we have his wonderful box of tricks that is full of magical buttons. One of these may be an ejector seat, we don't know. maybe any other kind of fun car weaponry that we've seen JB or James Bond use throughout the years. And it does still flip.
Yeah, my God, that's so cool.
Nothing's happened just yet, but who knows?
Now, if you haven't had, you know, if you can't, you know, afford a full Aston DB5, or you want to put this in your DB5 and, you know, sort of mock up what it would be like to have a Goldfinger DB5. That would be an absolute, and a great sort of a Bond provenance, you know, circuitous route possibly. But I mean, George Lazenby, you know, his own sort of gadgets from an Aston Martin. That's just uber cool.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic. And that piece is £600 to £1,200.
Again, not too eye watering.
No, not too much, and it's from an interesting kind of piece of Bond history. Whilst it isn't Bond directly, there is a very strong link to it.
Sure.
Through Fleming, Lazenby, JB. What a wonderful code name that is. we definitely didn't realise his disguise. But yeah, I think there is something for fans of any kind of spy, whether you have Mission Impossible, Man from U.N.C.L.E., you know, James Bond, of course, you have the full spectrum represented through our catalogue.
Do you have a particular, okay, one piece from the whole auction, what would you like to take home with you?
There's quite a few, but there is a piece behind me from one of my favourite films, Adam's Family Values.
Oh, yeah.
and that's Little Baby Watt.
Oh, sweet.
And it's the puppet of, so Cousin It,
yeah,
the little hairy guy.
Yep.
He has a baby in the second film. There's just this really sweet little creature.
Sweet.
And my heart just goes out to him. I find myself getting very attached to the cute pieces. We had a Fraggle from Fraggle last year, and the day he got packed up and sent off, I sort of you know, stood at the train window, shedding a tear. It's difficult not to get attached to everything when you learn the stories of all these fantastic pieces, where they've come from, what they've been through sometimes. You know, there's pieces that are 70, 80 years old and have, you know, come from countries you would never expect things to come from. And yeah, I think it's tough to choose when everything's so cool.
You've got a great, I mean, dream job. I mean, I always have such a great time. I'd love, massive thanks to Alex, who's been an absolute legend today. Graham behind the scenes has been helping set up all the, I mean, always a great guy to have around. Thanks to Steve Lane and Tim Laws as well, and Miranda, for having us here today. It's always a pleasure, never a chore. But from now, it's been Blair Ballard and Alex Howard bidding you a very bond farewell. Stay safe, friends. Now, if you've enjoyed this video, please do consider smashing those like and subscribe buttons. Do turn on notifications so you know when the next video drops. Also, leave some comments down below as to any videos you'd like to see in the future. But for now, stay safe, friends. We'll see you next time.